morning, everyone. I'm Makenzie, pronouns she, they. Well, this is nice and tall. I chose this chair and I didn't rehearse sitting in it, so here we are. It's good to see you all here. Today's sermon title is Discovering a New Path, and I just want to let you know before I really dive in, today's sermon, it's more of my testimony, love note or a thank you letter to Forefront Church rather than some deep biblical analysis. And I invite you to come along with me as I tell my story, and I invite you to consider your own along the way. Everyone has their own personal reason for finding Forefront and trying out this church. We often ask you that when you fill out the newcomer's dinner form, or it's an easy question to ask when you're meeting someone new in the house. But as you reminisce on what brought you here in the first place, I also hope that you consider what keeps you coming back for more. Something about God's timing is so incredibly divine and unpredictable and can feel unnervingly disruptive. For my 26th birthday, my boyfriend of 3 years got us tickets to see a Broadway show that I was dying to see. I had a college classmate in the show, and the original Broadway cast was filled with actresses who were just a couple years ahead of me, who were living into a career that I so desperately wanted to have as well. And this Broadway show called The Prom, it's about these two high school girls who just want to go to the prom together. One of the characters reminds me a lot of myself when I was a teen. She was on the cheer team. I was on the dance team. Yes, I danced at pep rallies. Her family's religious. My family is also very religious. She's overcome with fear that her parents are not going to understand if she tells them who she has feelings for. And for 26 years, I had that same fear. It's a really great show, and while that part of the plot is pretty heavy, it's actually a really funny and lighthearted musical. For those of you that have seen it, I see you nodding. It's a great musical comedy, and I went back to see it again. And again, and again. But the first time that I went to see it, my 26th birthday, disruption made itself known. I was sitting next to my boyfriend of 3 years. I was encouraged to share a picture, so I wanted to protect his identity. But yeah, we had been together 3 years at that point. He had been with me through all that comes with moving to New York City in your 20s. And as we sat there watching the show, I cried silent tears because I just knew that I was about to disrupt everything that we thought we knew to be true. It took me a few weeks, but I eventually did break up with him. And there were a lot of reasons that that relationship needed to end, but I made sure to use all of those reasons when he was asking me why, as I was packing up my stuff from his apartment, and I avoided the biggest reason of all. That following Sunday, that same week after I broke up with him, I decided to try running from this disruption that I was feeling, and I tried to do that by trying to find God again. Heard about this church called Forefront, showed up at the roulette, and I sat in the back row by myself. And the preacher, I've told this story before, so you might have heard it before, but the preacher mentioned very casually how, oh, we're not quite there yet, but thanks for that picture, AV. The preacher started to talk about how the LGBTQ community is beyond welcome here, and I had never heard that before from the pulpit. So that alone really, really struck a chord with me. I'm like, oh, hold up, I'm here to try and find God and wrestle with these gay thoughts that I'm having. And now here I am, and you're preaching about how that it's okay? I had never heard that before. And then we got to communion, and someone emphasized that all are welcome to receive communion here. All are welcome at the table, yes, even queer people. And that's when I lost it. These weren't cute, silent tears like when I was at the show. Oh no, if only. These were full-on ugly tears. I was sobbing, loud, snotty, raw. Don't know anyone here, just in the back, a complete mess. But it's because of this church and that first service that I attended that I finally came out to myself and to God. And the rest is kind of history. I jumped right into volunteering with the setup team. I sang with the choir on Easter Sunday 2019. That's what that picture was from, which is crazy. I joined a small group. Any chance that was offered to me to meet new people and build community, I took it. I jumped right in. I knew that I needed to be surrounded by people who understood, or, I don't know, surrounded by uncommon kinship, even before that became one of our values. This church carried me through the coming out process. And for those of you that are also queer or are close to someone who is, you know that coming out is not this one isolated moment. It's so drawn out. You end up coming out again and again and again. It gets kind of old after a while. And this church walked beside me through all of it, through the heartbreak, the nurturing, the anger, the grief, the growth that comes with coming out to not yet or not quite yet affirming parents, all while I was deconstructing my own faith. And it was messy. This church gave me a chance to reconstruct my faith and my life in a way that was whole, not compartmentalized. It didn't have to be my church life over here, my theater life over there, my newfound queer life somewhere else altogether. I was allowed, given this agency, to have all the areas of my life, all of my identities overlap and intertwine in all of its messy and beautiful ways. Younger me would never believe that members of my small group from church went to see me dance backup for a drag queen, for a benefit concert for the Trevor Project, in a nightclub. Yeah, that happened, and it disrupted everything that I thought that I knew, and it was good. I went digging for photo evidence. I even texted folks who've moved away and don't go to Forefront anymore to see if they had photo evidence, and none of us could find a picture. But here's a more wholesome pic of people from that same small group who came to see me in a play festival in the city that same year. This church gave me a job when I told them I couldn't afford to donate. I had only been coming here for about 8-9 months. I was giving about $5 a week because that's all I could afford. And I remember having this conversation with Jonathan Williams and just saying, I can't afford to give anymore, but I do have time. Where can I volunteer? Where can I help? And I got a job. That part-time job sustained me as we entered a global pandemic. When I lost all my other part-time jobs and the theater industry shut down, I still sang in the choir, but virtually. Along the way, I met and fell in love with my now girlfriend of 3.5 years. Sorry, Diana, but there's a picture of you. I forgot to warn you. We met in small group, in that same small group, by the way. Another thing that my younger self would never believe. Met a girlfriend at church small group? Okay. Something about God's timing. So incredibly divine and unpredictable, and can be incredibly unnerving and disruptive. At some point along the way, I went from this being a part-time job to, I guess, being a calling of sorts. I don't even know if I believe in callings, if I'm being totally honest, but I do know that I believe in sayings like right time, right place, or, you know, we make plans and God laughs. It reminds me of the verse in Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. All I know for sure is that something fell into such clear alignment. Something clicked. I fell into this job when I needed it most, yes, but also when the church needed me most. Forefront went through some really big disruptions back to back to back. Oh boy. Some of you were here for all of it, and we can have this collective exhaustive sigh together about it now. Some of you joined us after the dust had already settled and look around and hear some of us old timers sighing and you're like, what is happening here? When we were not only actively navigating a global pandemic together, we were also transitioning from virtual church to hybrid church. That was a weird time. Oh, when this church had its founding pastor and community director resign in the same year for different personal reasons, when we needed to hire and onboard two new co-pastors to live into this very new flat leadership model that we had just started, it was a lot. And I happened to not only be present and very much available with my time, but I was also ready in my heart and my spirit to rise up and say yes to something greater than myself, something more stable amidst the changing tides. For those that don't know, the operations position didn't exist prior to me. I created it. I saw a way to put my gifts into action. There was this missing puzzle piece. And as we shifted to a flat leadership model, I proposed that we discover a new path together, a way to maybe fill this stage managerial shaped hole. I often joked then, and I still joke now, that this role is kind of like the stage manager of the church. For those of you that have been a part of the theater community in any way, it's more so like the stage manager meets the company manager combined. But however you want to classify it, I wanted to find a way for our church, both the staff and volunteers alike, to thrive without the inevitable burnout that kept happening. It's a really lofty goal. It's still a lofty goal now, if I'm being really honest, but that was my driving force in 2021, and I clung to it. This church not only changed my life, but it saved my life. I don't want to get too deep into that part of my story today, but I do want to just say that I don't often let my mind wander there to the what ifs. The what ifs of if I hadn't stumbled into Forefront that day. The what ifs if I hadn't finally realized that God wasn't going to hate me for being gay. I don't let my mind go there because it's really dark. All I wanted then and all I want now is for this church to continue fostering this environment where people can come and feel welcome, where people can come and have their lives changed for the better. And in many ways, doing my part in keeping this church alive was all that I could think about. Amidst all of the instability and uncertainty of the church, I was dealing with those same feelings in my personal life. I've shared before, and I'll share again, I started developing a multitude of health issues that no doctor seemed to know how to diagnose at the time. And I was too scared and unfortunately embarrassed to talk much about it with the people in my personal life. Something about God's timing can be incredibly divine and unpredictable, but all that it felt at the time was unnervingly disruptive. The last time I preached in the fall, I talked about ableism and being someone who was newly wrestling with being disabled. I also was just interviewed by Deacon Jim on our Forefront podcast about my experience coming to terms with this changing body. Both of those things will be linked in the chat. Our wonderful virtual greeter, Rebecca, can drop those for us. And while now I'm proud most days of how I've evolved in my acceptance of my chronic illnesses, that doesn't come without the grief for what could have been, you know? And I certainly didn't have an easy time accepting my new reality in the beginning. I've had some years to accept it now. When I stepped into this position on the executive council in 2021, I had this vision for how my life would go. You know, we dream. We think of these 5-year plans, 10-year plans, this hustle culture in New York City. And I had this vision, and I was determined to prove this vision for my life to be true. I had this dream of becoming a person of parallel careers. I had long admired women who do it all, who have not just this day job, but they have a parallel vocation to their acting careers. When I fell into ministry and saw how much I loved this work, I couldn't believe it. Prior to this job, I never could fathom loving anything as much as I love performing. Prior to the pandemic, I often had 3 or 4 part-time jobs at one time, in addition to auditioning, which can kind of be a full-time job in and of itself, and I was able to somehow manage all of that, and my health, and my social life, just fine. But I also never loved those part-time jobs. I was able to leave them mentally when I clocked out physically and never looked back. They were a means to an end, but Forefront is home. Forefront's family. I'm not able to clock out of something that I care so much about. And prior to the pandemic, I wasn't chronically ill. Just in case I start crying again. Prior to the pandemic, I didn't have a thyroid disorder, fibromyalgia, sleep apnea, a cyst on my spine, and all of the symptoms that come along with it, like chronic fatigue, chronic pain, brain fog, limb numbness, migraines, now potentially POTS, postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. Say that 3 times fast. And so much more. The list is so long. It's almost comical now. Oh boy. I can only imagine what your answers might have been during the meet and greet. Prior to the pandemic, I insert old life identity vocation here. It's something that I feel like a lot of times we avoid even talking about, but we all went through this collective, like, cosmic shift together, and we're different now. Prior to all of this, I could very much have handled parallel careers. I know that. One thing I've learned, though, one of the many things that I've learned to grieve since becoming sick is that I no longer have the same amount of energy that I used to have, or spoons, if you know spoon theory. My limitations are different now. My capacity is evolving. And if I'm being really honest, I hate saying it out loud. I hate admitting it. As much as I would love to be someone who could still do it all, I know deep down, a lot of that's rooted in white supremacy culture. And I am continuously challenged to interrogate that. But more importantly, I know that I want to be someone who leads by example when it comes to being intimately aware of and in alignment with my body's needs and advocating for my body's safety and care. And I wouldn't be doing that if I stayed in this role. And I hate admitting it. It's so complicated to leave something that you love. My biggest fear in this resignation was that people would come up with their own stories or conclusions about why I'm stepping down, why I'm leaving the staff. So I'm so grateful that I have this opportunity to just share with you. I'm an open book. Those that know me, I have no poker face, and and I don't even try. I like to be transparent about where I'm at in my life and all the emotions that come with that. So if you do end up having more questions after this, we are having a town hall. I hope you stay. Ask your questions or hear other people's questions. And here's the thing. I don't want anyone to think that I'm leaving the staff because I don't like working here. Or because the staff doesn't want me to work here anymore. I love the forefront staff. I have loved this job and I love this church. None of that has changed, and I want to be super clear on that, okay? Love you too. I wouldn't be living into the very values and moral compass that I've established by being a part of this church if I stayed when my body and my doctors and my therapist and my inner circle are all telling me that it's time to step down. I've preached on learning to listen to my body. I've preached on ableism, and yet my internalized ableism has been so loud lately. Really, this whole past year, it's been screaming at me. Keep pushing. Find a way to power through. Other people can handle what's asked of you, so you should be able to handle it too. Or the Enneagram 2 in me starts to come into play and take over in that voice. They need you. You're causing disruption by leaving. Don't do that to them. Get over yourself. But then I remember to quiet that voice. And I try and pray and try and see the bigger picture. And when I step back and I look at everything, I see doctors telling me that stress is one of the biggest triggers for autoimmune disorders. I remember all of the times that my doctors in the past 3 years have asked me when the stress of working in ministry will subside. Oh, spoiler alert. No matter how much any pastor loves their work or loves their church, ministry is stressful. It just is. Rebecca, the virtual greeter that I mentioned, congregant located in Brazil, she's going to be dropping some links in the chat of research done on burnout amongst clergy. It's something that I really hope that we continue to dismantle and reconstruct within ministry, but it's easier said than done. I don't think you can be a pastor without caring a lot, right? Not a good one, at least. When I look at the bigger picture, I also think of a conversation that I had with Pastor Angela this week. She reminded me that one of the only constants in life and in ministry is that disruption is going to keep coming. Yes. It's not going to end. And we have to take care of ourselves in the process. And I see a church with not only a strong foundation built pre-pandemic, but a hopeful future, thanks to the immense care and collaboration of the current staff and leadership team and all of you in the congregation. We've been collectively digging ourselves out of what can often feel like quicksand the past 3 years. And now Forefront's in a position where we don't only need to survive, but we can thrive. We can dream. I'll never forget at our last town hall, Events Deacon Kyle asking, when can we start dreaming again? And the answer is now. Let's do it. Let's start dreaming again. And I'm proud of playing the part that I have played in this larger picture that was getting Forefront through some major disruption the past few years. And I also can now feel comfortable, maybe, passing the baton, even if it's bittersweet. So what's next for me? There's a lot of unknowns, but a lot of people keep asking. So this is what I can share, what I do know to be true for myself. My top priority will, of course, be my health. Anyone who's ever been chronically ill or disabled or who's been the partner of or a caregiver of someone who is knows that that is a full-time job in and of itself. Between scheduling doctor's appointments, going to doctor's appointments, getting more tests, dealing with insurance, flare-ups, advocating for resources, the list goes on and on. And that needs to be my priority. You're still gonna see me and Tilly at church. She was invited today, but girl declined, so. I believe in consent even for my service dog, okay? So she said, no thank you, and I said, have a good nap, I'm going to work. I may take a little break from being here on Sunday mornings, but I can't leave it entirely. I haven't had the option to sleep in on a Sunday in about 5 years, unless I was on vacation, and even then I would usually wake up to go on the live stream. But this is my church home. The staff, the leadership team, they know that I want to remain a part of this community. That's how I came in to this church. That's how I'm going to go out. I still will have my Flatbush small group. Diana and I are still open to hosting events whenever the time is right and our space is needed. I'm open to singing and guest preaching whenever the staff feel that it's the right time. Other former pastors have done the same, and that's what I intend to do as well. I'm leaving the job, but I am not leaving this church. Yeah. And you'll likely see me post more on social media, as many of you have commented on just in the past couple weeks, about auditioning and acting. And that's for a couple reasons. I never fully left that industry, but I am diving in a more intentional way now. And that's because I'm really invested and curious to figure out where disabled actors fit in the theater industry. And it seems that there are others who are curious too, but maybe don't feel as comfortable as I do being an open book and volunteering myself as tribute. If there's anything that feels right as an identifier for me, it's that I'm a storyteller. And as my acting teacher calls me, a trailblazer, whether I like it or not. If telling pieces of my story can contribute to paving a more inclusive and accessible theater industry for those that come after me, then I have to at least try. On the podcast, Jim asked me if listeners only took one thing away from the interview, what I want it to be. And I said, accessibility benefits everybody. I said that during my ableism sermon, and I say it again now. It's become sort of a tagline for my life. And I still don't know if I believe in callings. Maybe I do, maybe I don't. It changes on the day. But I do believe that God created us all with such unique gifts and passions and identities. And so long as I follow those, discovering a new path maybe won't feel so unnerving. I don't know if you believe in callings. Have you ever asked yourself, what are your unique gifts and passions? Are you following them? Bless you. Are you using those gifts? Are you embracing them? And are you taking care of yourself along the way? I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope in the future. I'm not being pushed out of this role. I like to think I'm being carried. The staff and leadership team, they've proposed ways to keep me on, especially with the fantastic fundraising that you all did at the end of 2023. That fundraising, that accomplishment, it gives us the chance to dream and could have allowed me to keep my job, but I know it's best for me to step down at this point. And as I've voiced this need and advocated for my body, I've been met with support and care and love and collaboration. It's time that I move on my terms, and I keep reminding myself that even though God's timing can feel unnervingly disruptive, I trust that it's also incredibly divine, and I hope that you do too. I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up as we prepare to take communion. As Vanita shared, it was Ash Wednesday this past week, and we're going into Lent. From dust you came, to dust you shall return. Life is unpredictable. Our next moments are never guaranteed. After you're served communion by myself and Robbie Klein, as it's our last Sunday here with you as staff, I invite you to hold your communion chalice that is gluten-free and alcohol-free in your hands and go back to your seat and sit in your chair in deep reflection. What does it mean to you to be invited to the table? What did it mean to you your first Sunday here? What does it mean to you that others who maybe have a completely different life than you are also invited to the table? What does it mean to you to receive ashes on Ash Wednesday, or as you think of others who did? As we reflect on this unnervingly disruptive truth of our mortality, may we also find comfort